All right, let's turn to the Supreme Court. From your perspective, and I've talked to a couple of people, there does not seem to be, you can slow things down maybe, mm-hmm. but you cannot prevent this vote. If Mitch McConnell has the votes, even putting some type of like halt on the continuing resolution, the Senate can still function even when the government shut down. And there doesn't seem to be anything that the Democrats can do at this juncture to stop this.
I mean, I'm looking at this also through the lens of the election, and I think what's really dangerous about this moment is, I mean, as Mitt Romney, who just announced that he's, for the vote, this is an opportunity for the Republicans and Trump to unite again. So for every John Kasich that supported Biden, which who knows now if he supports Biden in light of all this, you know, they're now bringing in the Mitt Romneys, bringing in those centrist Republicans, because it's something bigger in their minds, at least, than Trump and frankly, the pandemic. And that's why I think the Democrats need to put pressure on and say, no, this is about something much bigger, which is the pandemic. So I don't know, I mean, how they can potentially delay, as you just said, but if this turns into a rallying cry for Republicans to unite, I mean, we have some bigger issues here, which is an excited Republican base up against a, you know, what should be an excited Democratic base and looks like it in the polls, but I mean, who's to say?
All right, so let's talk, yeah. let's get real here in terms of like the politics of this, okay? Because it's a little bit, if it is the case, and I believe it is the case, that there is no way to stop this vote. And as much as I dislike Schumer, and as much as I dislike Pelosi, at least in terms of feeling like their efficacy in pushback, there, I just don't think there is a physical way, regardless of what their will would be, even if the entire Democratic caucus, which I think it is, would be aligned with them, there is any way to prevent this vote. If that's the case, and what you're saying is true, from an electoral perspective, if you're thinking about the election, how can we win back the Senate? How can we win back the presidency? It seems to me that what the Democrats need to do is make a fight of this, but only insofar as that it gets the Democrats upset from it, but not really to make it like, you know, almost like rope-a-dope for the Republicans. In other words, do not give the Republicans, they're going to get this sixth seat on the Supreme Court. That seems to be a fait accompli. What you don't want them is to get any political mileage out of it. Because I don't think, to a large extent, particularly in this instance, that voters are going to go, I'm more motivated to vote now because they sat this justice on the on the Republican side than if not, right? Like, there's no call to action here. It's just like, here's payback. Whereas on the Democratic side, the call to action is, you got to vote for us. You got to vote for a Democratic Senate, because we are going to maybe pack the court, maybe reform the court, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Right. Like, I mean, that's the only, it seems to me, like on some level, like I don't know if it makes sense if they're going to, if they're going to nominate Lagoa, or if they're going to nominate Amy Coney Barrett. I don't know if it makes too much of a sense to fight it as much as make it clear who he is and say that we only have one solution to this, and that is we need to take power, and then you hold us to account.
Well, this is why it was so dangerous. This is a perfect example, and any neoliberal who could potentially watching right now, or Biden campaign person, this is the danger in appealing to centrist Republicans over your base. These centrist Republicans, I am pretty much sure you've lost them. They are going to be supporting Trump because that means they get their nominee, which is more important to them for a million reasons.
Well, what
and
if
all of their justices that come with it.
Before the election.
What was that?
What if the nominee goes through before the election?
Exactly. So think about this. This and when you don't focus on your base, when you're just thinking about the data that's going to get you to win the election, and it is going to be close, and it might come down to state justices across the states, in swing states in particular, and could potentially go to the Supreme Court whether we get a new nominee or not. The only thing that stops that is an excited base and a large turnout. The only thing. So enough with appealing to the centrist Republicans to get you right over the edge. Enough with it. They're not loyal. They're flippant. Something like this could turn the arc of history because you decided you wanted to appeal a little bit more to the business class, the Mitt Romneys. Well, guess what? Mitt Romney is not loyal to the Democratic Party.
Right. And to be clear, Mitt Romney could come out to, you know, until he takes this vote,
yeah,
the idea that he's part of the resistance doesn't work anymore.
That's right. Right.
Because he can't come out and say, Donald Trump is the greatest threat to American democracy. Oh, excuse me for one second. I have to go vote for his sixth Supreme Court justice.
That's right.
Right. I mean, he is now neutralized. And, you know, Stuart Stevens can go around and say, you know, Donald Trump is horrible. Well, where are you on this Supreme Court pick? They are, their critique is now neutralized.
It's a cover, too. It's a cover. So they can say they're not for Trump because, you know, he behaves poorly. He leans into fascists and racists and sexists and homophobes and whatever. But then at the end of the day, you know, if that Supreme Court pick decides this election, who's to blame? They're assets to fascism.
Right. I mean, it's and I don't know. It looks like right now. Now, to be clear, I'll go through this tomorrow in terms of like what we think is going to happen to the ACA. But I think there is a decent. Well, it's certainly gone, I think, if Donald Trump wins. I mean, that is without a doubt. I you know, the implications of Donald Trump winning are, I think, I don't think can be overstated at this point.
Yeah.
I mean, we look at just in the run up to the election, all these things that are happening in these agencies and from across the board, right? I mean, DHS to HHS to EPA to FDA to CDC, they just took down the warnings against it being, because, I mean, just all of these things. And there's no, like, they have pushed the limits. Like, we, you know, like, they have spiked in terms of what they're willing to do that is antithetical to a properly functioning government. And that will be the baseline,
right,
if Donald Trump wins.
And not to mention, anytime you show up on the streets now, it is, as a friend of mine just told me before I got on, it is an act of law and order. Anytime you express any form of resistance on the streets in New York, Portland, wherever, you know, this is their opportunity to round people up and instill fear, which again is fascism. So as we know too well. So it is, they're literally just trying to take all of our tools away from us, including the Republicans.